Yes.
Today we'll talk about the various high-level language constructs, how we represent in MLIR with various work we did in FC compiler and SIL compiler. So we have seen so most of the C++ compilers today directly loaded on to LLVM-IR. So there are many problems with that. So here is one of them. We see this dead loop iterating over there. So there is the std map. The keys of the map are being iterated and there is nothing in the loop. So this is a dead loop, but currently with O3 or OFAS, LLVM doesn't remove this loop. So this costs around 10%, but there is no optimization happening. This is mostly because of the lower level various APIs which are found in the CFG-based loop, which LLVM is not able to recognize. So this is one more example where we have a simple stack and the 10 is being pushed. So ideally with O3 and with no exceptions, it should have been 10 as the return value. But we see some memory allocations which are totally unnecessary. We see around 578 bytes being allocated and just deleted. They are just deallocated and there is a store of 10 which are totally redundant. So LLVM is not able to utilize this. And we can go on and on with many examples. Like we have simple stack push and pop, which doesn't work. And also here you see a constant propagation thing for the std string. So which is a simple thing where we should return a zero, but LLVM doesn't see this and it just emits the normal IR. So there are various things, and the other problem which is quite serious is that there is no support for multidimensional arrays. So all the accesses are linearized using kept sort of instructions, and there have been a lot of effort going on recently with LLVM upstream about how to make it delinearized with some intrinsics. There were some metadata approaches and none of them fit well, and it affects the loop transformations. So, and one more problem with the LLVM which is trying to catch up is there are a lot of heterogeneous programming paradigms which are being supported in Clang like OpenMP and all, but LLVM is not able to support it. It is being overcome by using various built-ins and intrinsics, and there are a lot of runtime calls which LLVM doesn't understand. So something like a GPU compilation needs cross-module optimizations, which is not supported in LLVM. And there is also an increasing trend of using C or C++ in the DL inference engines. Like you can see Intel MKL and other libraries being trying to use, but LLVM is not suitable for those kind of things. So because of these things, there is an increased use of an higher level IR, which is, so most of the modern languages like Swift, Rust, and Julia have their own high level IR, which is just after the AST, and then they lower down to LLVM IR for further lower level optimizations. So this slide is from the original MLIR talk, where the picture indicates that we are missing an IR between the AST and the LLVM IR for Clang, and it actually helps a lot. So we'll just start with the basic MLIR introduction. So it is basically a framework for building IRs at any level. It need not be high level, it can be a low level as well. So it supports various ways to define our own set of IRs, which can be called as dialects. So there is this, you can have a new operations or types on your own and define your own dialect and make it interact with the existing ones. So in tree, there are various dialects like affine, SCF, which is standard control flow, which helps in providing various loop nest optimizations. So MLIR can also be used for some lower level assembly kind of instructions as well. So as I mentioned before, there are various things why various pitfalls with the LLVM, which is why we need the MLIR for C++ kind of languages, and Fortran is also a higher level language compared to C++, which desperately needs some middle end optimizer. So there is also another goal of providing an API independent IR, where if you've given C plus C, C based MLIR solution, where you can probably port it to different architectures as well. So then there, it also helps in various heterogeneous programming, like you can directly have an OpenMP kind of operations in the C, and you can directly interact and have a cross optimization between the regular CPU flow and some target specific flow. So because of various things, we wrote the FC compiler and the SIL dialect, which currently has basic loopness, data layout, and LTO support. We have two C benchmarks and two Fortran benchmarks and one C++ benchmark passing. So here we'll talk about various constructs, what are the problems with LLVM IR for them, and how we overcome it in MLIR. So here you see that there is this Fortran array representation. So Fortran supports a multi-dimensional arrays. Here you see a four-dimensional array of size, and the layout of the it is column major layout. So in LLVM you don't have much option to represent the Fortran array. So what happens is it is represented as a structure with a raw pointer and other metadata related to it, like dimension, lower bounds, and upper bounds. So this becomes a raw pointer with some offset, and you can see that it is all gets and store instructions, which it is very difficult to get what is the feel of the actual access. So in FC we have something like an array type which is directly from the AST. So there is an higher level MLIR dialect which gets converted from the AST to that FC dialect. So the FC dialect almost holds all the information which is contained in the AST. Here you see an example where the two-dimensional array is being represented as a FC dot array type with all the dimensions and type retained. And we can do several optimizations in this FC array type, such as remapping and other array based optimization which is specific to Fortran language itself. And then we'll lower down it to a standard dialect as a std member with a column major layout. So here we can expose it to various affine and other loop transformations which already exist in MLIR. So, and then the std member has its own implementation in the LLVM IR, which gets converted to the LLVM IR. So there are these two additional steps which are possible because of the presence of MLIR. So one is the Fortran specific stuff which we need to handle at the higher level, and then the existing loop transformation framework which is present in MLIR can handle these kind of can handle lower level stuff. And then again it is exposed to LLVM, which can do its own kind of optimizations. So similarly, there are Fortran array sections. The array section is the section of an array which can be used for computation in Fortran. Here you see an example of A of 10 array, where you have a next statement A is equal to 1, which is storing all ones to all the elements in the array, which is of size 10. And then the next line on the left, it is printing the section of the array, which is from A of 2 to A of 5. And the equivalent program is shown on the right hand side. So in LLVM, the array sections are handled by, so in most of the Fortran compilers, the array sections are converted into a loops in higher level in the AST itself, but which is suboptimal solutions. In MLIR, we have dedicated operations and types for doing array based operations. So here you see a loading of two arrays and adding it. The load %6 and %7 loads two arrays of size 10, and then the array add i operations add both of them and produces the register value which can be stored or loaded. So here it how it goes. So you have let's say an array of size 10, we assign 10 to it. That means all the elements will have 10, and then we lower it to an assignment statement where LHS is the full array and RHS is the vector of 10s, and then it is converted into a store where A is again an FC dot array type and the right hand side is a vector of 10s, and we can perform various optimizations on the different array values here, similar to what we do for scalar, something like CSC, ins combined, DC and all those things. And then we lower down to a Fortran dialect with as a do loop, which we will explain later. So, and then to an affine for, and then to the LVM based loop. So in each of these steps, we can perform various transformations on the various abstract levels. So here is one such transformation where you see that the left hand side, the A is equal to B plus A is basically a dead code because B is 0. In LLVM, this program generates 4 to 5 different loops where each one of them does its own thing. It is very difficult to identify all these loops and do a transformation of DC. Whereas in MLIR, you can easily say that the B is all zeros and you just ignore the A is equal to B plus A part. So here is another optimization where we can do. So here you see that there are two additions on A is equal to B plus C and B is equal to A plus C. So you can basically combine these two expressions and store the right values to A and B in a single loop. But this can be traversed in the IR and we can do a ins combined kind of thing and lower it. But this is very difficult in LLVM as it is a separate loopness and you need to identify the adjacent loops and then combine it and do all other stuff. So there are several other constructs which handles on higher level arrays in Fortran, something like where construct. Here it is saying whether any element of A is greater than 3, then assign the value of 2 to that particular index, else assign B equal to 3 for the same index. So there are more such constructs like for all and all those things which needs an higher level IR. So even in the case of loops, we have the same kind of stuff. Here is a two level deepness loop. So we can ask questions like, is this a perfect loop nest or are those loops adjacent? So LLVM takes costlier time and it is not accurate to do such analysis in LLVM. So the same can be represented in MLIR using a different loop operation. Here is an example from SIL. So this is a doubly loop nest on the left side where we do a matrix addition and it is represented using SIL dot for loop operation, the initial SIL dot for loop contains a region and the region contains various operations and the SIL dot for loop arg1 is the one of them. So we can easily do a loop transformations on this rather than on the LLVM IR. So similarly, we do have an operation for FC dot do loop where the do loop is converted into FC dot do operation which contains the induction variable and the lower bound, upper bound and step. All the loop statements are a nested reason statements in the MLIR and it returns an SSA variable which is the updated induction variable value. So MLIR also, since MLIR support nested regions, we can have an operation for the if inside the do loop. So here we represent it using loop.if. So all these aids the transformation and analysis of various loop nest optimizations. So there we also tried to do some unstructured control flow support. Here we have an exit and cycle. So these are represented as an operation, and it, the semantics is that it inherently returns the SSI value. So about the overall control flow, the do loops in the source code from the Fortran is converted into a do statement in the AST, and the AST is has a preliminary analysis to see whether this is a structured control flow. If it is so, we lower it to a SCF dialect, or it was called as loop dialect before. So we lower it down to SCF dialect, and then we can and then we analyze the same SCF dialect to see whether this is an affine loop nest. If it is an affine loop nest, then we do some transformations on the various types of various operations, and then we lower it down to an affine loop nest. So in the affine loop nest, it is easier to do certain loop transformations, and there are also existing loop transformations which work on the affine dialect. So we utilize them. So now Ranjit will talk about the C, how various C++ constructs are supported in MLIR.
Yeah, thank you, Vinay. I'll just share my screen. I hope my screen is visible.
Yes.
Yeah, sure. So let's see how or what are the high level constructs in C++, like classes and other features like operator overloading, inheritance, and all those things, and see how they are currently represented in LLVM, and what happens if we try to represent them in high level, and what are the challenges and what are the advantages. So starting with classes. Classes are like basic thing in C++. Here we have a class, class A. It has two members and one member function. When this particular class gets lowered to LLVM IR, right? What happens is class gets converted to a structure, and the function will be the name will be mangled, and it will be represented as a independent function in LLVM IR. So the idea or like information that all these are part of same class, and there can be other some optimizations done on top of it if we know this information is lost in LLVM IR. So what we tried is we defined an operation to represent classes or C++ classes. So it looks something like this, whatever in the RHS. So so we have a class operation which can represent the member function as well as data members. Data members are defined using specific or dedicated operation. We have a dedicated operation to represent the field access. I mean to say, whenever a particular field is accessed inside a member function or outside a member function, we represent using field access operation. Also, we have like yeah, so you have this operation or representation in the IR. So just looking into the IR, it's very easy to read. You can say, oh, this member belongs to this class, and it's easy to read as well as and in the analysis phase, if you're doing some optimizations on top of C++ or classes, the analysis becomes easy compared to LLVM. So yeah, so what happens when we lower, right? So what we do is we don't directly lower the class or SIL class operation to LLVM. So we lower it to a corresponding SIL or low level SIL. What happens in the low level SIL is the class gets converted to a structure, and all the field accesses becomes struct elements. This is kind of very similar to LLVM, but in LLVM you have GEP and all those things. I mean, GEP is like uniform for everything, right? But here we have again like a little more abstraction, like structure to access the structure elements, and the function name will be mangled, and this pointer will move away with, and the pointer operation comes into picture, and in the LLVM IR, you know, right? So ultimately, it gets converted to a structure, which has two fields, and function becomes independent. So the advantage here is we have like for a given class, right, two to three levels of abstract IR. So you can do different kind of transformations at different level. You can do some optimizations at high level and some optimizations at low level. Basically, you have a hierarchical IR or multi-level IR. So that's the whole idea behind this. Even once you have classes, representing templates becomes pretty easy. You take the data types and define independent classes for it. And so it's very straightforward. You let's say there are two variables getting created here, O and O2, and you define alloca operation and create the corresponding variable. So it's quite similar to the classes. So in case of operator overloading also, it's straightforward. You have class operation, you represent using sealed class operation, and the overloaded operator function becomes an independent function with some mangled name, and everything inside the function is represented using a dedicated sealed operation, like anything, maybe alloca, or if you want take address or access a global variable, there's a dedicated operation to it. So everything has an operation, and so it's straightforward. So in case of inheritance, right, when we define class operation, we kept information like whether this class has any base class or inherits from some other class, right? So this information can be printed in the IR as well. So we have a list which keeps track of the parent classes of each class. So that's printed here. So in this example, right, you have a C, class C, and which is inherited in class B. So basically C is a parent of B, and you represent that in the IR. So in case of LLVM, it's like just two different structures, and it becomes difficult to analyze there. So here we can in the IR, we can clearly see, oh, this is the parent of this, or this is the child of this, and the analysis becomes easy. So the optimization as well. So moving on, we explored like STL things. So here is something interesting piece of code from C++. Basically, there's an insert operation and there is pushback operation. So in pushback, we push like three different elements using three independent statements. Insert, we insert three elements at a go. So the code on the right does the same thing. I mean, the ultimate result is same, but the three elements that are pushed using pushback operations are inserted using insert operation. So the advantage is during insert, you know how many elements you are inserting. So basically you can reserve so much places in the vector and then insert. So in case of pushback, every time you need to keep allocating the memory, right? So that's the advantage. At a go, you can allocate required amount of memory and insert. So these kind of optimizations cannot be done, or may be done with very difficult analysis in LLVM. So representing all this in SIL or maybe a high level ML dialect in MLIR gives us advantage to do this kind of optimization. So if you look at the IR, right, for the same case, in the left case, the allocator gets called thrice. That's for these three pushback operations. On the right side, you have the allocator gets called only once, and the elements are inserted at a go. So you have 1, 2, 3 here, and they get inserted in a go, and allocator allocates the memory in a single operation. So here is another example. So here what happens is you are pushing 10 elements to the vector, but the upper bound of the loop is 10, and you know you're pushing 10 elements. So ultimately the size of the vector after this loop becomes 10. But what's happening in the IR is every time you push back, the allocator gets called and memory gets allocated every time. So 10 times you need to call the memory allocator, right? So that's kind of overhead to the memory allocator. So what we do is we see the loop, and as Vinay said, we can represent the loop as a standalone operation without a traditional basic block kind of loop. We have a standalone operation which defines the loop and get the upper bound, and you analyze what's happening inside the loop analysis becomes easy compared to LLVM, and see, okay, this is going to run from this 0 to 10, and only 10 elements are pushed, and you reserve the 10, that's allocate 10 elements, then start inserting the element, right? So here is the corresponding IR, right? See, you can see the allocator gets called and you pass 11. 11 is nothing but 10. So that's only single call of allocator, but not inside loop. But here allocator gets called inside loop every time, right? Every time one element gets allocated. So that's the advantage. If you represent all these high level operations in SIL, and you can, analysis becomes easy mainly. And once analysis becomes easy, you can easily do any kind of transformation. So moving on, we have some Fortran modules. So Fortran modules are something very similar to C++ classes. So you'll find the data members, or they are called with different names, but the concept is same. You have like functions, subroutines, also scope, right? Private or global, private or public. So all those information remains same. So what happens is, when a Fortran module gets lowered to LLVM, we have again the same problem. All the elements, be it global variable or subroutines, everything is split and represented as independent element in LLVM IR. Ideally, basically the information is lost. So if we keep all this information at very high level dialect or a high level IR, we can do some optimization on top of it. So here is how a Fortran module is represented in LLVM, right? So we have a module here, and this is a global variable, and we have private subroutine, that is mod func 2, and this by default mod func 1, mod func becomes public one. So when this gets lowered to LLVM, so what happens is these two becomes two independent functions, and the global variable becomes the module variable becomes global. So by looking at LLVM IR, you cannot like conclusively say all these are parts of same module. So saying, or the advantage of such information is that, say, let's see, the modfunc2 is a private member, meaning to say you cannot call modfunc2 from anywhere outside. Only the guy allowed to call this function is modfunc. So you, and the operation happening inside is like just modification of another global another module member. So you can definitely move this inside. Basically, you can inline it or do some optimization. So, but here also you can inline it, but you have to look outside this function for its users, and all those extra complications will come. So basically, something that can be done done in a very simple manner becomes complex. So we defined a operation in FC dialect, FC Fortran dialect, to represent Fortran module, and similar to class, every access is represented using a dedicated operation, and we can represent private public members as well. And during the lowering, it ultimately gets lowered to similar kind of LLVM IR, but we get the hierarchical representation. So this is how it looks in the FC dialect. So you have the Fortran module operation. So this is from here to here, it's a module operation. Inside the module operation, you will find two different functions. So these are basically embedded inside this operation. So the idea that these are part of same module is kept, and similar to the class operation, we have this information in the IR. Okay, this is part of this module and this is part of this module, right? So that's the beauty of MLIR. You can literally represent anything in MLIR. So during lowering, so first it gets lowered to a lower level IR. So where it becomes very similar to LLVM IR, right? The variable becomes global variable, and functions are moved out of this operation and moved to the actual MLIR module. So, and the operation Fortran module is completely lowered in this case. So another feature in Fortran is Fortran that can be improved, or that can be optimized using or taken advantage of representing at high level MLIR, is nested functions or nested subroutines. So basically, in case of nested functions, you can define a function or a subroutine inside a subroutine. So again, in this case also, when it reaches LLVM, right? So it becomes like this, two independent function. So here A is used inside this, and when they become independent, the A is passed around. So again, if you're going to inline, you have to look outside for it, look outside for its uses and all. So the analysis becomes complex. So what we did is we have a dedicated operation in this case also. So and also the variable A in this case, we say that this is being used somewhere else. So for that also we defined an operation. So as you can see here, the function sub1 contains another function called func, and which becomes a nested function. So and inside the func you are using A, which is from sub1, so that's also represented in the IR. And in the parent one, we say A is implicitly captured, meaning to say it's being used somewhere. So that information can be used when we are trying to do some optimization on top of A, right, in the outer function. So this is the advantage of representing a nested function in such a manner. Again, when it gets lower to a low level IR, you separate out the function and pass around the argument similar to LLVM. So moving on, we can take the advantage of MLIR or MLIR, various dialects in MLIR in OpenMP as well. So here is something. So this typical or small OpenMP program, we have a parallel region, and the right side is optimized version of the same program. So what's happening is, see, the Y is assigned a value 2, and Y is being used inside this parallel region, and Y is passed to another subroutine or another function, and inside the function Y is getting printed. So what I did is basically did a constant propagation, that's interprocedural optimization, moved or propagated value of Y to the subroutine, and now you can inline that as well. So it's like very basic optimization. Now the question is whether LLVM is capable of doing it. So if yes, so what is the amount of analysis required? What will be the impact of it in the compile time, right? So basically, LLVM might not optimize it because it depends on how this parallel region is lowered in the IR. So what happens in case of OpenMP is any parallel or target region is outlined to a function, and that function will take certain amount of arguments as in, like, so in this case, right? So Y and A is used in this scope or in this parallel region. So Y and A are passed as pointers to this outline function, but outline function won't be directly invoked. So the pointer to outline function will be passed to an OpenMP function, and that OpenMP function will in turn invoke this outline function. So basically it's not a direct call, it's a transitive call. So what happens when you have such a transitive call is basically, it will prevent the interprocedural optimizations. So that's the main drawback here or catch here. So we are going to improve it a little bit by representing this OpenMP constructs in a high level MLIR dialect. So I mean, this is how it looks in LLVM. So you have KMPC fork call in place of that parallel region, and basically you pass an pointer to the function, and that function will be invoked. So what we did in FC is we defined a dedicated operation for OpenMP parallel do, and in this case, see, so we know that 2 is used here, I mean inside the parallel region, and we pass that 2 as an argument to this operation. When I say argument, it's not an independent function still. It's you can see this operation is still inside foo, right? So you can do any kind of, I mean, you know this 2 is being used inside, and you can go inside this particular operation and see whether it's a read use or write access, read access or write access, and conclude whether 2 or y is constant or not. I mean, it becomes easy to analyze because you have the outlined or the region to be outlined inside your function still. So you can do all those optimizations at high level itself. Yeah.
Thank you, Ranjit and Vinay, for the amazing talk. It seems like it may have, you know, taken a great effort to achieve it. It's a very amazing work, and it's very, I would say, enlightening to see that, you know, you can easily represent so many things so easily in MLIR. Yeah. So someone would like to ask some questions?
Yeah, so I have a question. So you mentioned that we are having higher level representation using SIL or using the FC dialect. So I'd like to understand what is the entity over which we are running these analyses, because in case of LVM, we know that we are running our analysis over a CFG, but clearly when we represent loops in such ways, or even I think even conditions or classes and these kind of things in at a higher level, I don't think they exactly look like a CFG. So what do you consider as an entity over which you run these analyses?
So the CFG is just the representation of the loops, right?
Yeah.
I'm not sure what exactly you are looking for. What do you mean by what entity?
So, like when we are running an analysis in LVM, we know that we have a CFG, and we are analyzing a CFG. We know exactly what are the predecessors, successors, and whatnot, dominators, everything. But yeah, in case of SIL as a dialect, the loop doesn't really look like a CFG, because like there are things outside the loop, there are things outside the loop on both sides.
So the thing is that you still can have a basic blocks and all in MLIR. So here the loop is an operation which is very well defined. It's like you still have let's say the loop operation is in a separate basic block, then you have the values coming in for the loop which are based out of SSA, and you still have the values going out of the loop as SSA. And you have the boundaries defined for the loop as well, as the lower bound, upper bound, and the size. I mean, that is all the information which we need from any loop representation, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so those things are represented in much easier form. So if you want, you can lower it down and have a normal CFG representation for the loop as well. So the operation provides you, the specially defined operation provides you an easier way to do the same transformations or the analysis. What part do you think is missing?
No, I don't think anything is missing. I just wanted to understand what is happening.
Yeah, so we still get all the data we need for the loop in a much easier form. The back edge is not exactly there, but we know that it exists, right?
Yeah, so I think that must be something implicitly present in the in-memory representation as opposed to
context. So if you see, if you do the same kind of analysis in LLVM and get it into the loop info, so the similar kind of stuff is printed in the IR itself.
Thanks. I think someone has a question.
That basically answered my question.
Okay.
Please feel free to unmute yourself and ask a question.
Sorry, I've got a question. So this part of the analysis, I'm guessing that it has to be some part of, is it part of the front end? That, because this seems to be more high level, and the structures that we use probably are more closer to the source language. So in the pipeline, will this be followed by some front end analysis, or is it part of the back end? Is that how you are envisioning this?
So Yeah, we can say it's a middle end kind of thing. So it is between the AST and the LLVM IR. And again, you can have the lower level forms in MLIR as well. So these dialects, high level Fortran dialects and C++ dialects, is kind of middle end between the AST and the low level IR.
Okay.
I have a question. So MLIR is eventually going to be lowered into LLVM IR, right?
Yeah.
So right now that you explained that if MLIR was absent, so how that code would be converted to LLVM IR, so that would be unfortunately we wouldn't get much optimization opportunities, but MLIR is giving us those opportunities. So I am little curious how that MLIR code will be lowered to LLVM IR. You showed the course, you displayed the course where MLIR was absent and LLVM IR was there, and the MLIR one, but not that one which would get which would be the LLVM IR after MLIR is processed.
So in most of the constructs, we still see similar kind of LLVM IR being emitted. So the optimization which is currently being carried out in LLVM still holds good for whatever the MLIR, the LLVM IR generated from the MLIR. It may not be in the exact form, but it will be in the similar kind of representation. So it won't be much different.
I'm a little confused because how that would be does the optimization happen at MLIR level?
No, the optimization happens at all the levels, even in the MLIR and LLVM. So what we are saying is LLVM is good for certain kind of lower level optimizations, which happens even with or without MLIR. So what we need is those optimizations which are being missed because of the LLVM problems.
So yes, exactly. Those the optimizations which are being left out because of these things are happening in MLIR.
Yeah, they are happening in MLIR.
Okay.
So is this an entire front end that has been written separately? Is it like the mid level thing in between this pipeline? This part
so
of the pipeline.
For the Fortran work, yes, we wrote the parser and from there we loaded it down to the LLVM IR with our own stack. For the SIL part, we have a Clang, we took the Clang AST plugin and started lowering it down.
Okay.
So do you plan to upstream SIL in any way?
So there is a plan of upstreaming SIL in some time.
Do you have a GitHub link for the CIL repo?
No, not yet.
So I have a question. If I consider a small C or C++ code, we have normal C and C++ code, then I have a loop in between that code, right? And when I started lowering it from the AST, I lowered some part of my C++ code to SIL, and I lowered loop to some dialect which can better represent loops. So what I'm not able to understand is that now my IR representation at single point of time has two dialects. Some components are in SIL dialect and some components are in loop dialect. This question also applies to any dialect, because my understanding is that at any point the whole module can have different type of operations from different dialects. So my question is, if there are different type of operation from different dialects at one point of time, how can we perform an analysis on the whole module if things are some operands are from some dialect and some operands are from some dialect which we have no control of?
That is like a difficult thing to do, but the idea is that we only perform certain optimizations at certain level. So for example, we only look for loop optimizations when we have affine.
Okay.
So Yeah, and let's take Fortran example, right? So once we lower it down from the AST, we have mostly the Fortran dialect operations. So whatever the Fortran specific optimizations we need to do, that will be handled in the higher level dialect. Once we move lower down to other dialects, let's say, let's take loop or arrays, for example, we only concentrate on such kind of things for specific dialects. There are specific optimizations for them. Let's okay. say you want to do a loop transformation and you don't know what are the array operations or the load and store are from different dialects. What you need to see is that whether it has any side effects or which you don't understand. So it is mostly specific to the operation.
Okay, so it is something like that. For if you want to deal with these operations, if you can support what you need from them, then you can eventually, you know, use those things, and the infrastructure is available for doing such thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. So the affine, it doesn't worry about where does the load and store come from or the values where it gets fitted into. You can have your own array type, and then you can basically cast it to an affine dot load and then do a loop transformation on top of it. Okay. It's all about the side effects of different operations. You should define them properly, then the existing transformations will work.
I'd like to add a point. So basically everything is an operation, and you can define side effects to every operation. So when you do some kind of analysis or transformation, you look for a particular kind of operation. So you need not to worry whether this from this dialect or this dialect. So basically you just look for some kind of operation.
If I understand correctly, the motivation behind MLIR or CIL is to lower those languages which treat arrays as first class citizens, because lower level languages may not have first class, like LLVM IR may not have first class support for arrays, and thus it might meet some abstraction removal opportunities.
So to handle all those kind of things which are missing from LLVM. So arrays is one of them. Loops and other things are the others.
Right, so for a language like C, which doesn't really have support for first class arrays, MLIR might not be much relevant, or does this speed up any of the C programs as well?
No, but there are other issues with C, right? Something like heterogeneous, and then the ABI dependent. Currently, the AST itself has some target specific things.
Right.
And you have OpenMP and all those things which are currently not optimal in LLVM IR. You cannot optimize it.
Loops is the main C.
Right. So you could recognize loops at the source level and represent that as a construct in the MLIR.
You can represent it as a standalone operation, right?
Right.
When it gets to LLVM IR, you need to run some analysis and detect the loops ultimately, right? But
right.
Here you have a dedicated operation, and you just need to find the operation and where it is. You don't need to run any kind of analysis to find loops.